Harvey, when you get a call from someone to take on a project or to consider a project, what are some of the first things you do to make sure that you want to commit to it?
First of all, I look and see if I have kind of the bandwidth to do it, the scheduling, and it's something I can fit into my workload. And then more importantly, I look at it from the standpoint of, is it something that's going to be really, really good, really, really high quality, something that I'm going to have fun doing, something that is not going to be like coming to the studio every day like, oh God, what am I working on? I just, at this point in my career, I want to do great things. I want to do projects that I'm really proud of and do things that I enjoy creating.
Mm-hmm. Well, definitely with Sing, I can see why you would want to take that project on.
Sing was a no-brainer for me because it was so much great music. It was working with an amazing cast and one of my favorite directors and kind of studio head combinations I've ever worked with Chris Meledandri and Garth Jennings. Those guys were just amazing. I always love working with Mike Knobloch at Universal because he's a real musical guy. And so when he calls me with a project, usually it's something exciting because it has so much music. He's really intense about music and he loves it. And so again, when he calls and said, hey, I got a potential project, I usually stop what I'm doing and really, really concentrate on what he's talking about because it's usually something fun. It's Straight Outta Compton I did for him, the James Brown film Get On Up I did for him. So just, you know, real music intensive projects.
Right. And I know in another interview with Jennifer Hudson, you two talked about how some of the music is much older and a lot of generations, even millennials, may not know some of these artists, unfortunately. So I think it's great that you're bringing people in.
That's really been my kind of goal with some of this music is to freshen it up a little bit so that young people can enjoy it and listen to it. And maybe that will make them go back and listen to some of the stuff that artist had done before. And it introduces it to them in a way they can digest it, I think.
Right. Going back to something you said earlier about wanting to enjoy what you're working on, I know you're at a point in your career where you can probably be choosy, which is probably an excellent place to be, but what is it about a project or how do you decide that, you know what, I think maybe this won't be for me, and was it always that way for you? Were you always at a place where you thought, I don't want to work on it because I'm not going to be committed 100%?
No, I wasn't always at that place because I used to commit to everything 100% and it got really draining and tiring and it taxed my creativity. You know, for years and years and years we were doing records and artists that were not great artists or artists that you might not think would come out, and a lot of them didn't come out, and a lot of it were, we wasted a lot of really good material, good songs on artists that we probably shouldn't have been working on. But at early stages in my career, I just wanted to create. I wanted to be in the studio, I wanted to be working, and I wanted to perfect my craft. So I used a lot of years doing things that I otherwise wouldn't have done. But I think it all is a progression. It goes in stages and one thing leads to another and gets me to where I am. I worked with artists that were new and I didn't know if they would come out, but it ended up, I worked with one of them being Chris Brown, who was 14 years old when I started with him. And at that time we were doing a ton of artists for Jive Records. A lot of them were new or unsigned and you never know what's going to hit and what's not going to hit. And he ended up being kind of a career artist for me and somebody I've done, you know, tons of songs with. So early in my career, I definitely took the approach of work with everybody, give it your all, pour everything you have into every project. Now, as you said, I'm a little bit more selective and I really try and concentrate on stuff that I think is going to be great.
Well, I think you started out with jingles in the beginning.
I did.
And would you say to, let's suppose someone new starting out, whether it's in music producing or film, acting, whatever, take on every project you can at first, but then once you get to a certain level, choose which ones are actually going to fulfill you instead of drain you?
Absolutely. And I would say take on every project. No project is too small. You can learn from every project. You can improve from every project. You can also build your name and reputation with every project. Early on in your career, I would recommend anyone in the arts, you know, acting or creating anything, I would say start with doing everything you can. Get your hands on any project because you can always improve, you can always get better, you can always build your reputation and build your name. You don't know who's going to hear that song that you wrote for that horrible artist, and then it leads you to a great artist. And also you don't know what you're going to pick up from any given session, any given artist. You can learn one of the things that lasts you an entire career. I learned so many things early in my studio sessions that have stayed with me forever and all the way to this point where I do what I do now. A lot of what I do now, I learned really early in my career. So that's a formative time in your creative process early on. And I don't think at that point you can afford to be choosy. I see a lot of people doing that and like, oh, I'm not going to work on that. I'm not going to work on that. And I think that's a huge mistake. I think you do everything you can because there's always some little kind of tiny nugget you're going to get from every day you show up to work in the studio, and it's like repetitions. You have to do it, and you have to do hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of songs to get to that place where you're creating great ones.
Harvey, once you say yes to a project, what are some of the first steps?
When I take on a project, I start researching it, looking back and seeing what it is that they've done before, or reading any kind of background material, scripts, outlines, things like that. If it's an artist, I'm listening to all the music they've recorded, listen to what the voices are, listen to who maybe the actors are. And in the case of some of these movies, you're looking back in the history of the music that's going to be featured in the films and kind of seeing, okay, what can I do to these songs to make them contemporary and relevant? How far can I push them? How careful do I have to be, because there's some classic copyrights there that you don't want to tamper with? So you start researching it, and then you kind of just start laying out an organizational plan on how you're going to attack the project. The latest film I'm working on had, I think, 70 songs in it. So, you know, you have to be a little bit strategic with how you do it. My next project is broken out into kind of three different groups of styles of songs, so I kind of start organizing them. The next step is usually kind of start casting and thinking about who am I going to use. The director's casting the film, I'm casting the music. Who am I going to use to create the right sound for each individual piece of music? And luckily, living in LA, we have access to the best musicians and best vocalists, so I can pull from, you know, amazing group of talent. But you really, part of my job is to specifically make sure that the people I bring in accomplish the sound that I want for that particular piece of music.
Okay, let's talk about Sing then. So once they presented you with maybe the script and you knew who some of the voice actors were, how did you fit the different songs for each character?
Well, that was a trick because there was so much material and so many characters, but ultimately what the job was for me was to take kind of the playlist that they had put together and figure out what was the personality of each character and how could I translate that into kind of a sonic or a genre specific sound for them. So Ash, the Porcupine's real edgy, rocky, you know, so we just knew the songs that she was going to do had to have that edge. Reese's character is very pop and kind of cleaner cut pop artist, so those songs obviously kind of led us down that sound. So you really, it was about recognizing the personality of the artist and then just figuring out which songs worked for that, and then ultimately making sure that I gave them that consistent sound.
Now, once you decided which artists you were going to use, what is your process? Are you contacting the songwriter or the artists themselves who performed it? What's the process like getting approval?
Once the songs were chosen and approved by the director and the heads of the studio, there's another person that works with us. His name is Jojo Villanueva. He's the music supervisor. So his job was specifically to go and license and clear all these songs. I think he cleared almost 100 pieces of music. So that process involves going to the publisher, going to the artists, record companies, performers, all those people, depending on if we're going to use the actual master recording or we're going to recreate it. Just kind of, there's a couple of variables there, but he has to reach out and negotiate all those fees and prices and usages, and that's a nutty job. He's been doing that for Sing for almost 2 years. Wow. It's a big job.
Were there some songs that you presented and you thought, you know, this would be a great match? I know you had Elton John, you had Stevie Wonder, Leonard Cohen, but other people didn't think it was a match, and your process for proving your point or working with them, maybe just turning over the control to what they want, what was that like?
Well, to be honest, I didn't choose a lot of the songs. I added my opinion, and there's a few songs that I brought to the table, but a lot of the songs were chosen by the director. And so because he chose those songs, there wasn't a lot of people we had to prove it to. You know, maybe Chris Meledandri, the head of the studio, but for the most part, it was really Garth knowing the songs he wanted, and then how do we make those songs work in the context of the film? And that was the position that I was in. Like, Garth loves the song, but he doesn't know how to piece it together, how it's going to fit, and he's not even sure that it is. So if anything, I'm almost taking his idea and trying to prove it back to him. Like, yeah, Garth, that's a great song title. Let's figure out how we can flip it. In other cases, like the grand finale songs, there was some uncertainty about some of those songs. And we went back and forth. We tried three or four different songs in different spots. And I would do little rough demos. Don't You Worry About a Thing was one in particular where we did a lot of versions of, a lot of improvements too. We started at one place and like we started over here and we ended up way over here on that song. So ultimately, you're just trying to create the right emotional feel and just hit the right beats for the director and for the story with the music. So you're choosing the songs based off of that, but once they're chosen, you know, you can take a song 10 different ways in production. This is all how you produce it, the tempo, the key, the instrumentation. So as long as I was aware of what the song needed to accomplish, I was able to take those songs and manipulate them to kind of fit the scene.
So all of the actors were doing their own singing?
Yeah, all the actors did all their own vocals. They rehearsed for a while. We did a lot of recording sessions with them. They worked with a vocal coach, and then I ultimately ended up producing the vocals.
So they would come here to your beautiful studio in North Hollywood, and how many hours are you working, let's say, on one song?
Well, different people would come here, but a lot of people would go to other studios throughout LA, depending on where they lived, because we want to make it convenient for them. And also, we were spending a lot of time recording, so we would probably do 3 hours at a time with sessions, because a lot of the actresses and actors, they don't have that endurance for singing. You know, that takes a lot of work. They're used to acting. They're not professional singers. So we would record for a few hours, and then we would come back the next day. And I think most of the sessions went really smoothly, and I was super impressed with how good they were at singing. I mean, they're not even singers, and these guys could probably have been like pop stars if they wanted to be. I mean, Reese and Taryn was amazing, and Scarlett was incredible. Had they decided to do that instead of acting, they probably would have been able to do it. But since they were actors, you have to take special care in working with them on their vocals. So to answer your question, we would go maybe 2 or 3 hours, and then the next day we'd come back and try it again. And also, these people are filming other movies and they're working on this movie, so it's not like you can just work every day. You're doing a day here, and then in 6 weeks we'll do another day, and you know, so it was pretty stretched out.
So let's say you have a session with one of the actors, you think it's good, and then what, you present it to Garth Jennings and he approves it, and what if it's not the emotion that he wants? He gives you notes, or?
Well, yeah, we didn't really have that problem too often. Garth was really collaborative with me and really cool to work with, and he really trusted kind of what I got with the actors and actresses. Also, Garth was involved in some of those sessions. He would come to the studio. He would also be recording dialogue on a lot of the days that I recorded vocals. So he would be there. He would give his notes to me, he would give his notes to the actress or actor sometimes, and then I would figure out how to translate what Garth was saying into kind of musical terminology and get what we needed. But more often than not, by the time we finished the song and I kind of finished editing it and turned it in, Garth was really, really happy.
Which of the characters in Sing is most like you?
Wow, I don't know. Probably Buster Moon, I would say. You know, always got some big plan and always trying to pull people together and work on something exciting. And he's a producer ultimately, you know, he's like putting together a big show, so I think I would identify with that. Not so much hopefully blowing up his theater, but other aspects of him I could identify with.
So for Sing, what was the tone and the feel that you wanted to create? Or maybe that wasn't really up to you, that was more Garth's doing, but what tone and feel was the ultimate goal?
The tone and the feel, actually, there isn't a unified tone or feel, and that's the beauty of the movie, and that's why I think the music was so important, is because the beginning of the movie introduces you to the theater and introduces you to kind of what the setup of the story is. It's kind of a high point. It feels really good and big and kind of overwhelmingly huge. And then it gets into the details of the story, and there comes some hardship, some tragedy. You've got you know, the gorilla's dad, you've got the Reese's character and her husband who's not paying attention to her. There's a lot of little stories in there that you're like, oh man, that's really sad, or that's too bad. And you're kind of introspective a little bit, and you're thinking about things, maybe how that relates to your life. And then things happen throughout the film that you're up, you're high, you're excited, then you're down, you're bummed. So if you're asking what the basic feel of the movie was, I think it was just real emotion, you know. And what I was trying to do with the music was to take all the emotion and heighten it. Just exaggerate whatever you were feeling and use the music to really, really drive that emotion home. So as I said, I think it's a lot of upbeat, happy excitement, and then there's some moments where you're sad or you're really thoughtful.
I think back for me watching Solid Gold, Friday Night Videos, Soul Train, Kids Are People Too, stuff from, I mean, I'm dating myself with all these shows here, but that everybody kind of has this dream of being able to perform. Can you talk about how that emotion and that secret fantasy that everybody sort of has about being in the spotlight correlates with sing? I mean, I think that's why so many people can relate to it.
Yeah, I think there is a component of people wanting to be able to perform and sing, and it also kind of boils down to people clapping for you and, you know, like saying, oh, that was great what they did, or appreciating you. And I guess there's some of that in all of us where we want to be accepted and liked, and music is one way of doing that for sure. You get the admiration of a lot of people by standing on stage and singing the song. So that's why American Idol's popular, X Factor, all the shows. But I don't know. I think sing is definitely something that a lot of people can relate to. There's everyone sings in the shower, right? I do.
What do you sing?
Usually songs that I'm working on. Usually whatever the last thing I just produced is. You know, we just started working on Pitch Perfect 3, so I've been singing a lot of Pitch Perfect songs nowadays.
I think a lot of people know what an executive producer is for a movie. Can you talk about what the role is in terms of music?
Yeah, an executive producer for like a film, an executive music producer would be responsible for all the music. Anything that has music in it, I'm going to have a hand in making sure it sits a certain way, it sounds a certain way. Producing songs if I need to, or having somebody else produce the songs if I need to. Just really making sure the music has a uniform sound and some continuity to it, I think, is the reason you have an executive producer on the music side. Otherwise, you're kind of hiring a person to do this and hiring a person to do that and somebody else to do that. It can get a little bit sloppy, and it can also get disjointed, I think. So my role in this particular film, in addition to producing, I think, 70 songs, was to just make sure everything on the music end was handled properly. And I was the liaison between Mike Knobloch, who's the head at Universal of Music, and then my music team, and I was the kind of the go-between for the filmmakers as well. So that was my role on this film, and it's the best job in the world. You know, you get to make music every day and see it come to life on the big screen.
I know the style of music varies from your projects. I mean, Straight Out of Compton versus Sing, you're going to have just a totally different feel. But from what you're actually doing, is it very similar? I know the type, the genre of music's different.
Yeah, the process is always similar because you're trying to serve the director and his vision, and you're trying to use the music to help tell the story. If you've noticed kind of on my discography, my filmography, I really don't take a lot of projects where music is just like background stuff. It's like the music is important, and those are the projects that I want to be involved in. So helping to tell the story is always your job as the music producer, and really helping the director to realize his vision is your main goal. So whether that's doing, you know, a cappella music for Pitch Perfect, or doing like complete urban, you know, hip-hop records for Straight Outta Compton, you're just trying to tell a story and you're trying to convey the emotion through the music.
So switching gears a little bit, I was wondering if you could take us back to where you were in your life when you switched careers. I know you were a basketball player for a while. I know you grew up in the music business with your dad, but then you played basketball. And then there was a point where you switched careers. Can you talk about mentally where you were, physically where you were? How was that?
Yeah, when I was playing basketball, my dream was to obviously play in the NBA, and I had a career-ending injury, which kind of made me change direction and made me focus or refocus on music. And that was a tough time because I really had planned on playing basketball and I'd worked my whole life to do that. But in the long run, I think it was a really fortunate, you know, turn of events. You know, to get hurt, you never think that's a good thing, but it turned me towards music, and it made me really, really take all my energy and effort that I was putting into basketball and put it towards music. That was right at the time I finished college, so I was young and I was still malleable enough to just adjust and, you know, switch into something else. But music was always a passion of mine when I was a kid. I think I started taking piano lessons when I was 6 years old, 7 years old. And it was a hobby all through college. So it was I always kept my toe in the water with music. And then when basketball finished for me, it was just definitely a kind of a wholesale refocusing. I started doing jingles, and locally in Arizona where I was going to college, I started doing commercial music and working for ad agencies. And, you know, I was doing music for anybody who wanted it, brake stores, you know, buses, things like that. I would make a jingle for anybody. And all the while I was trying to get to Los Angeles to kind of kick in somebody's door to listen to my music. And that took me probably 3 or 4 years driving out to LA and for a week at a time, trying to get people to listen to my demos. I was sending cassettes to people back then, you know, throwing cassettes into people's convertibles and doing anything I could to get my music heard. And that was kind of how I started here in LA, was just driving out here, sleeping in my car every now and then, whatever I had to do. And then one guy took notice. He said, "Hey, I love what you do. I'll pay you, I think, $2,500 to do a job for him." And at that point, that was like, oh my God, I'm in. I made it. And that was my first job, Motown Records. I did a remix for one of their artists. And then I end up here doing an interview with you.
What year was this?
That was probably 94, something like that.
Okay. So you said earlier that you take a nugget of something from each project and there's some lesson in it. So looking back at the jingles, maybe creatively it wasn't the most fulfilling, maybe it was. What did you take from that you used then to build this amazing studio that you have here that's absolutely beautiful?
I tell you how I took so much from that 2 or 3 year period where I did advertising music, because you have to do every range of music. And some guy says, "Well, I want it to be country western, and you know, my burger joint, I feel like it's, you know, a country place or a blues music, or I want this kind of music, I want classical." So you have to be able to do all those types of music. You have to be able to deliver it quickly, and you have to be able to do it economically when you're working in a small market like that. So it was an amazing training ground for me. The other thing that I got from that is working outside of your own bubble of creativity. Like, you can't do whatever you want when this guy's trying to sell cars with his music. You have to do what he thinks is going to help him sell cars. So you really have to pay attention to what people want. You have to be able to translate what they're thinking, because he's a car salesman or a brake store owner or a guy who runs a mall. He's not a musician. You have to figure out what he's trying to get to with his music and figure out how to get it out of your fingers and out of the speakers ultimately. So that's what I use every day, with whether it's an A&R guy for a record label or a director for a film, being able to take what they say and what they think and what they feel and making that come to life with music is something that I do every day. So that's great training. And then, as I said, being able to do all the different kind of genres of music and being able to have access to my background being in all those types of music. I did so many rock and roll commercials, so many, you know, classical commercials that I can draw from that now when I'm needing to do a piece of music for a film.
Okay. So you've seen so many worlds. You've seen the music world growing up with your dad, you've seen basketball, you know, advertising, and now here in LA, which is a totally different ball game in many sense, no pun intended, by the way. But at the risk of sounding too like cliche with this, but talk about the dark times and how you can come out of them, because I'm sure you've seen a lot, whether it's just your own life or from other people. And how do you maintain a balance? Because this is a very, very up and down town.
It is an up and down business, up and down town. I think you get caught up a lot here, specifically in LA, about the approval of other people. And I think our whole industry is built on approval of others, because you don't get paid if other people don't like what you do. And so you're literally exposing yourself every day to, like, hoping other people like what you do and ultimately hope they like you. So that's dangerous, I think, to a person's psyche, to their personality. It's almost better if we lived somewhere else and didn't have to deal with that. But that's just the reality of art, right? It's subjective, and you are not going to be successful if people do not give you their approval and say, "Oh, I want to buy that record or that painting or that sculpture or that film," whatever. So that's the dangerous part, and that's when it gets dark, is when you don't have enough success to support your not ego, but just not enough support to feel good about yourself, and you start doubting your art or your passion, or is this what I'm supposed to be doing? Am I good enough to do it? Maybe I shouldn't be doing it. And the funny thing is, that's a part of Buster Moon. You know, there's a part in the movie where he talks about that, and that's so real and so true, and it pertains to anybody who's ever moved to LA to try and make music or try and be an actress. It can test your will, it can test your dedication. A lot of people give up and they don't make it. I don't have the answer on how to push through it, other than believe in yourself and continue to try and improve. You know, ever anybody told me that they didn't like what I did, I took it personally, and I really, really would go back to work, and I would sit in my studio at the time, which was in a bedroom, and I would just bang on my keyboard and make another track, and then turn it, nope, don't like it, do another one, get better. And I would really take like a competitive approach to it. I was an athlete, so everything to me was like, I have to beat the next person. So rather than start doubting myself or questioning myself, I took people at their word. I said, it's just probably not good enough. Let me get better. And I think that served me well. And I think I still try to do that when I'm doing a project. In the back of my mind, there's people I'm thinking about that I want to do better than, and there's other people that I want to hear this. And some people I want them to be mad because I did such a good job, and other people I want them to be proud that I did such a good job. So that's definitely a constant motivation for me.
Well, you can even see and sing that some of them have a few chips on their shoulders, and that's not really a bad thing. We always hear that that's such a negative thing, but maybe it's actually good to have it, because it's a driving force that if you don't, you'll get pummeled.
I don't know. Different people have different ways of dealing with it and coping with it. Some people make music or make art just for themselves, and they're happy with that. And like, forget what everybody else says, and I'm just doing this because I love it. And that's one way of doing it. I just chose to be very competitive, and I have kids. I want my kids to be proud. I want to leave a legacy after I'm done. I want people to think I did good work. I want to be able to lay down at the end and be like, yeah, I'm happy with what I did. I'm happy with what I left behind. I think art is a really important part of our culture and our society, and if I can create anything that lasts beyond my life, I think that would be great. Not to get too philosophical, but some of that is my motivation. It's not just about sitting in a vacuum and making music that pleases me. I'm trying to do things that might affect other people in a positive way.
Harvey, is every day a work day for you?
Simple answer, yes. Every day is a work day. Yeah, there's a lot to do. If I'm not always in the studio, I'm on the phone, I'm emailing, I'm doing a ton of meetings. There's a lot of discussion, talking about what's coming up next, talking about, you know, the song that we're working on, talking about a scene. So it's always work.
What time do you normally start your day, and do you put in 8 hours?
I put in more like 18 hours, and I start anywhere from, you know, 9 or 10 in the morning and go till, you know, 10 or 11, 12 at night, sometimes into the early morning if I'm working on a project. So it just really depends on where I am in the phase of the project.
We always hear about entrepreneurs that they can't really turn it off. They're always working, whether they're at a restaurant and they're on, quote, vacation.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that as part of your life? I mean,
yeah, I do suffer from that a little bit. As I said, I have kids, so that pulls me out of it for sure. When I'm around my kids, I'm not really thinking about work at all. But it's tough. If you love what you do, you want to continue to get better. You want to continue to grow. You want to build. At least I do. So, and I love making music, and I love working with the people that I work with, and I'm excited. It's not work to me, it's fun.
How satisfied are you with your work at the end of the day? Or are there times when you're not satisfied, and that's almost a good thing because it keeps pushing you?
No, I think there's times when I'm satisfied, and I try not to stop a project until I'm satisfied. I don't do things that I don't like. I don't turn in things that I'm not proud of. So when I'm finished with a project, I'm usually pretty satisfied. I think production is a series of compromises, though, sometimes, because you can't always get everything exactly the way you want, and maybe that's the perfectionist in me, but I'm always tinkering, I'm always trying to try something else. Let me try this tempo, let me try and add this instrument, or take this background vocal out, or build this bigger. And But that's the fun of it. It's like building a, you know, a skyscraper and just doing anything you want, just adding another floor and adding some more windows and just continuing to build this amazing kind of, hopefully, masterpiece. And at the end of it, if you're not happy, you're not proud, then you did something wrong. You probably better go back and rework it. So I get a lot of satisfaction from my finished projects.
Was work ethic something you were born with, or something over time you just picked up, whether it's the sportsman in you, the competitor?
Yeah, I think it's a combination. I definitely was into working hard, but I learned a lot from my dad, who was really, really a hard worker, and he preached that at home a lot, you know, really dedicating yourself and sacrificing and making the most of your talents. My mom and my dad were both musicians, so they were all about practicing and getting better. And then I had some great coaches. You know, I had an amazing high school coach, John Gofredo, and an amazing college coach, Lute Olson, who's in the Basketball Hall of Fame. And those guys both showed me the meaning of, like, setting a high bar, setting goals, accomplishing things you don't think you can even accomplish, and expecting more from yourself than you thought you could do. And that definitely translated to music. And I think that's something that a lot of musicians don't have, because they didn't play sports like I did. I played sports my whole life. Since I was, I don't know, 7 years old, I was playing sports all the way through college. And playing in college at that high, high level, you have to be, like, hyper-competitive, and you have to be sacrificing and intense and goal-oriented and all the things that you have to do to play high-level college basketball or professional basketball. Those aren't things that most musicians do. So I think I brought that to this end of what I do. And I don't know, I think it's worked for me. Hopefully I haven't made too many people angry how competitive I am, but I think it usually works.
I heard a quote one time that says, if people in Hollywood aren't mad at you, you're not doing anything right then.
Yeah, I guess so. I don't know. I've tried to be easy to work with. I've tried to be the person that people enjoy being around. And I think at a certain level, a lot of the CEOs of these huge companies, you know, that's when it gets to the point where people are going to be mad at you one way or the other. But right now I feel like I'm in a good place. I feel like my company's in a good place. People respect what we do. They find it easy to work with us. I think it's still a service business at some point. You're providing somebody with a service. So I think it's important that, you know, you treat people the right way. And I don't know, hopefully people like me.
Yeah, I actually meant it in the way that sometimes people in this town resent someone for getting a project that they didn't get, or something like that.
Yeah, I think that's true. And there's definitely some of that. I don't do that. I think there's so much great work that anytime somebody else gets something, I think it's great for them, you know. And it's not like I'm dying to have all those other people's projects. I try and stay positive, and I try and be thankful for what I have, and I try and support other people and encourage them as well. So we need more of that in Los Angeles.
We do. I saw an infographic that talked about entrepreneurs, and it said that some of the traits were that they were obsessive and that they kind of had ideas that other people couldn't understand, but that's what set them apart from other people. Do you think in some sense the people that come here maybe aren't obsessive enough or not competitive enough, and then they leave and go back home because they have friends and family waiting for them? Whereas if you have that sportsman mentality where you almost have to win, that's going to set you apart.
Yeah, I think that is something that sets people apart. And I think anybody who's accomplished anything really, really amazing, I mean, there's a few that are lucky, but most are not lucky. It's just really hard work, and it's being competitive or being intense and sacrificing. And that's really in any craft or trade. I think, you know, if you look at all the biggest actors, they're not the biggest actors for no reason. You know, I worked with a couple of them on this film. Reese Witherspoon is a powerhouse. You know, she produces, she directs, she acts, she sings, she does everything. And she's that successful because, number one, she's smart and really talented, but there's thousands of smart, talented people. She is driven, and I'm overstepping my bounds because I'm not that close with her, but from what I have observed, she's super hardworking, super smart, super focused, and I'm sure somewhat competitive. She wants to win. So I think that is something that sets you apart.
Can we talk about being in the studio with an artist? What's a session like? You could even
sessions are big fun. I mean, we have a ball in here. This is like, it's like Disneyland. If you like music, this is where you want to be. You know, it's music happening all the time. There's musicians in and out. There's singers all over the place. But my normal sessions are If I'm working with an artist, they're in here, we're listening to the music, we're talking about what we want to do, we're going over the lyric sheet, making some notes, then they'll go into the booth, I'll stay in here, we communicate back and forth, and we just start recording. And my engineer sits here, he's been with me for 10 years, Andrew Hay, super amazing, talented engineer and producer in his own right, but the two of us will just be in here going at it, and sometimes it'll take an hour, sometimes it'll take 6 hours. I mean, we have a crazy range of the amount of time that it takes. Sometimes it takes 7 or 8 days to record a great vocal. Sometimes people can nail it in one or two takes. And it's just a lot of collaboration. You know, I suggest ideas to the singer and they say, no, Harvey, that's a horrible idea. But I say, well, try it anyways. You know, just negotiating. There's a lot of psychiatry going on. You know, sometimes I'm trying to make them accomplish something emotionally that they're not in the mood to do. So I have to do, trickery, whatever I need to do to get them to act and sing a certain way. But that's part of my job, and that's what I do with everybody that I work with. And, you know, my goal as a producer is to make the artist that I'm working with give their best performance or have their best song, but ultimately have the best performance that they've ever had. And that's how I try and approach all my productions.
Let's go back to 1994. The world was a much different place then. No social media. Most people didn't know about the internet.
So
only a few computer science majors knew about the internet. Talk about the hits, the ability to create a hit, to have something go viral before the word viral really existed, versus today, when everyone's trying to get everything go viral, whether it's their cooking video, pet video, and how much harder it is today, or maybe it's not harder?
I'm sure there's some quantitative study you could do to figure it out, but I feel personally it's equally difficult now as it was then. Everybody's trying to do the same thing. You're trying to get your music heard, or your TV show seen, or your movie watched. And there's different technology now, but it's the same thing. It's asking people to like what you've created and putting it out in front of people and giving them choices, giving them the option. I think there's more choices now because of technology, and there's so much more content that's accessible to consumers. But it's the same game. It's like, try and create something amazing, try and create something special, something that hits a nerve with the public or is so real and so relevant that they want to have it. And then you'll have something viral, as you said, or you'll have a hit. Same game.
Well, I think so many people try to game the system now with a viral video, whether it's showing a baby do something or a cat. But it seems like there's no real, unless there's an algorithm we don't know about, there's nothing we really can do. Can you talk about projects you've been surprised at, where either way, you don't have to name the names, but in terms of like putting something out there and thinking it's going to be a hit, or the other way around, and then seeing the public respond in a different way?
Yeah, the weird thing is I try not to focus too much on that. I like to focus more on the creative process and do things that I think are great, and as I said, things that I have fun doing. And once I'm finished with them, I try and release them. You know, maybe that's just me protecting myself from failure, but I just say, I did a great job, I love what I did, I love this piece of, you know, art that we created. Hope other people like it too, and we put it out in the world. So I don't really have a great experience or great story to share with you of something that was so disappointing or something so surprising, because you don't know what's going to work. You don't know what people are going to take to. If you're a successful producer in the music world, at least, you have to have your taste somewhat aligned with the general public. What I like hopefully lines up with what the people like, because when I'm here making music, I'm not thinking like, oh wow, I wonder what all these people are going to listen to, or what they're going to like on the radio, or when they stream this, or how it's going to sound to them. I'm listening to what I like, and I'm making it to please my personal tastes, because that's the only thing I know is what my tastes are. And as long as my tastes and my likes and dislikes are somewhat aligned with the general public, then I'll continue to be a working producer. If my taste falls totally out of line with what's going on with the public and I lose touch, then no one's going to hire me, because I'm going to be making complete misfires, and I'll be making stuff that's not translating to anyone else. So that's kind of a simple formula to explain how I think producers that are successful are able to keep working.
So let's say there's a young person in their car driving from Arizona to LA and you have a quick phone call with them, what would be your tough love encouraging?
They're coming here to work as a music producer or a songwriter?
Music producer could be anything within the industry, but just the general foundation.
It would be a pretty long conversation, but I would start with saying, like, if you're going to come to LA, be prepared for how competitive it is. There's so many people doing whatever it is you want to do. There's thousands of them already here. There's going to be another thousand of them coming tomorrow, and they're all probably going to be better than you. So when you get here, be prepared for that and figure out what you're going to do to get better than them. Come here with the mindset of, I'm going to have to really bust my butt to make it. Because a lot of people come here, they think, I'm so talented. My parents think I can sing. One of my teachers at my college said I'm, you know, a great songwriter, whatever. But that's what everybody here is. Everybody here is amazingly talented and beautiful and handsome and whatever it is. So that would be my first bit of advice. And then the other thing I would say is be persistent. You can't quit. You can't give up. You have to prepare for the long haul. It's not going to be quick. You're not going to come out here and land an audition the first week you get here, or produce a song that goes on the radio, you know, for years. You know, it could take you years. Be prepared.